This. How do I understand it?
That the abstract defines the material and the material defines the abstract.
Good, yes. That's, the abstract defines the material defines. Yes, yes. Look, the main thing to bear in mind is that we are here seeing how with Einstein, binary thinking divides entities into material and immaterial. The whole thinking that relies on clear-cut distinctions between me and you. For Einstein, you know, you and me are not opposites. We are connected through the equal sign, and the difference between us is only the result of us being moving in different speeds and having different velocities. Yeah? But really, there's not a clear-cut distinction. Yeah? There's no clear-cut distinction between an image and an object, or between a work of art and something that is not a work of art. What makes a thing suddenly into a work of art? At what point Duchamp's urinal becomes an artwork? According to Einstein, it's just a question of intensity, of acceleration. Yeah? It's in the past, if you didn't do it in oil, on canvas, or in tempera, or in a fresco, it was not a work of art. Einstein and Duchamp say it's not a question of either or, it's simply a question of acceleration. It's a question of speed, of distance, of mass. You can take any object, and if you give it enough mass, enough speed, enough acceleration, it becomes a work of art. You take wool, for instance, Linda, from which people make ordinary clothes, and no one will say that your jumper is an artwork. Of course, it would be ridiculous. We understand that the jumper is not an artwork. But you take the same wool, you give it certain mass, you give it certain acceleration, and it becomes an artwork. So it's not a question of essence, it's just a question of speed.
Yeah, but that equation only works for like in the quantum side. It doesn't apply to the...
Why not?
You mean because general relativity doesn't apply to our immediate visible reality, the like the Newtonian? It doesn't apply to the Newtonian. So if we like use that equation as what would like to explain what time can take, that's must be fixed, but that is well.
Well, first one thing to say is that Karen Barat, for instance, says that the point of quantum physics is not that there is another layer of existence beneath the Newtonian or above the Newtonian, which is quantum. Quantum physics shows that Newtonian physics is simply wrong. It's simply wrong. But this is not the point. The point is that you don't need to go to that. Duchamp is enough. Duchamp and Einstein here are on exactly the same page. What is a ready-made? It's an everyday object that was given enough mass, enough acceleration, enough energy. It's basically being spun. A bit like, you know, like political spin. It's being spun until it rotates so quickly that it becomes a work of art. Yeah? So it's not about, you don't need a divine spark, you don't need to be a genius. What does it mean to be an artist? Well, you don't need to be kissed by the muses. You just need to find a way to accelerate something. And you can do it in a washing machine, like you do. You can do it, you know, it completely changes the way we think about that. And that's why, you know, it's not a question of talent to be an artist. At the same time, it's a question of something. But it's not like you need to be, you know, your parents don't need to take you to museums when you're a child. You don't need to be listening to classical music. You don't need to wear a beret, smoke a pipe. You don't need to drink absinthe. All you need to do to figure out is how to spin something, how to give it energy, and that's it. Yeah? So this is a very interesting shift that Einstein introduces that we can see happening throughout the 20th century. The main thing, what is the effect of advanced technology? Oh, well, one of the effects of advanced technology is that it becomes increasingly difficult to distinguish between things that are artificial and things that are natural, things that are virtual, things that are real. It's just really hard when you look at something, it's really hard to know whether it is real or not, or what version of reality is it, reality 2.0, or you know, what kind of reality we are talking about. That is the condition of modernity, of the 21st century, that it's hard to know when you look at an object whether it is an art thing or just a thing. That's the way to understand E equals MC squared. On the other hand, could you look? Could you read us the next one?
On the other hand, and especially in his general relativity theorem, how could one square the ever-expanding universe with the notion that there was no outside? Like in Escher's two hands drawing themselves, the very thought belies a certain kind of logic. It's creepy and zen, all at the same time. How long is this piece of string? This long. And what of the silent mass of anti-space, anti-matter, anti-energy? Well, Einstein had an answer to this. He called it a kind of cosmological stasis, which occurred if one took the logical probability of high-density dynamic relativism to its nth degree. At some point, there would have to be stasis, despite an ever-expanding universe.
What do you hear? How do you understand that? What does it mean?
So is this like the Möbius strip we were talking about yesterday? There's no outside. There's no outside. But
you remember what it's called?
How can we get?
How do we call this thing? Möbius band. Yeah, the Möbius strip, Möbius band. That's right. That is very helpful. This ever-expanding universe. Is it still the case? Is it still ever expanding? Ever expanding into what? What is beyond? Well, now it is this big. Tomorrow it will be twice as big. But where is it expanding into? What is on the other side of the universe?
Inside.
That's deep. Somehow, Einstein has to give a shape to this impossibility. It's really hard to hold together the notion of the expanding universe and the notion that there is no outside. Why there is no outside? We abandon the outside with the E equal MC squared. We understand that there is no inside and outside. There is no image and thing. There is no matter and energy. There is also a question of acceleration. If you accelerate matter enough, it becomes energy, or an image, or an atom. Yeah, that's the meaning of E equals MC squared. Okay, then we're going to there are two things I want to talk to you today about. I don't know if it's too ambitious. I want to talk to you about Gödel's theorem, and then I want to talk to you about Deleuze's notion of the faults, because that's the trajectory of this whole story, starting from the Enlightenment and looking at the Newtonian scientific time of the Enlightenment, then looking at the problems Nietzsche has with it, then Heidegger bringing his question of technology, Einstein then has his own idea of time as relativity, of change as relational. Then there is Gödel and his antecedibility theorem. And finally, there is Deleuze with the powers of the force. So, okay, let's have a quick look at Gödel. Gödel might sound a little bit sort of, but actually it's really, really fascinating. Let's have a look here. Could someone else read? Michel? Okay. From here, theory of the ordinal.
The theory of the ordinal is easy as 1, 2, 3. Forget about fractions or fragments of a whole and the ubiquity in betweenness of the idols, ors, and universe or life. Let us inhabit for the moment the ordinal, seemingly basic comfort zones. Admit it, saying the phrase, whatever plus one. In this zone, let us allow the whatever to be any whole number, including zero, between naught and infinity. Now, according to Gödel's famous, infamous theorem, any ordinary, that is to say, whole number within any ordinary calculus, has an additional multiplication, or their relative ordinary systems is always already undecidable. That is to say, is always already neither provable nor unprovable within that system. This may seem counterintuitive, for have we not been taught that n plus 1 is always n plus 1, or 1 plus 1 is always 2, no matter where or how or when? A scandalous irritation to normality and ordinariness, to be sure.
Right. Now, just read to us from the quotation here. Gödel was the first.
Gödel was the first to prove any unprovability theorem for arithmetic. And his way of proof was subtler and deeper than the metamathematical methods previously employed. Either of these facts would have ranked this paper high in the development of mathematics. But it was the fact that it was a proposition of whole number arithmetic which created such a scandal.
Okay, so what is this scandal in mathematics that Goldie is talking about?
That any whole number is not in fact whole, it is both whole and unfinite.
Okay, good, yeah. But I think it is in the right direction. The scandal is Gödel, Austrian, I think, mathematician who, like Einstein, immigrated to the United States, and he was working in Princeton. He developed his antecedibility theorems as a response to the Principia Mathematica, which is a book by Russell and Forget from the beginning of the 20th century, which is their great attempt to systematize mathematics and logic, to show that logic and mathematics are both mutually validate each other. So Gödel, and the way he arrived at this is fascinating. It's really, I mean, I wish we had time to look at it. But you can get the tiny book of the Gödel's theorem, which has a really useful introduction. And it will, if that sounds interesting, you will find a lot of information there. So essentially, Gödel have shown that in any mathematical system, even the most simple arithmetical one, arithmetics, you know, we're not talking here about any high mathematics, simple addition or subtraction. 1 + 2 = 3, this kind of thing. In every arithmetic system, in every mathematical system, there always will be propositions that can be neither proved nor disproved. Yeah? Which means, even in the simplest mathematical system, there will be propositions about which there is no absolute certainty. Why is that? Well, for the very simple reason that no system can fully account for itself within itself. Yeah, this is not a mathematical insight. That's simply, it's almost like you could go back to the Zen paradoxes and statements like, I'm from Crete, all Cretans are liars. Yeah? All this kind of, you know, this sort of the typical paradox, this sentence is a lie. This sort of thing, yeah? So you can, so on the very basic level, this notion that no system can fully account for itself within itself. Later on with Lyotard, this is going to be called the differant and will acquire very interesting political connotations. Because there are many situations in which the... Let's not talk about it. Let's just concentrate on Buber. Okay, concentrate on Buber. So, okay, one way to get into this whole story is through something that is came to be known as Russell's paradox, the same Russell with whom Buber argued. And Russell's paradox deals with the problem of series or the problem of sets. And can there be a set that contains within itself all other sets? Yeah? So the example, this paradox has many ways of telling it, but the one that I think Russell himself uses is this, the story of the barber. Yeah? So there is an island, and in the island there is a station, a military base with, let's say, some soldiers. And there is a barber. And what is known about the barber is that the barber shaves all the people who do not shave themselves. Those who do not shave themselves are shaved by the barber. Okay, you get it? So the question is, does the barber shave himself? Yeah, and what is the answer? If the barber shaves himself, then he is one of the people whom barber doesn't shave. Because the barber shaves only those who do not shave themselves. Yeah? So if the barber shaves himself, then he is one of the people whom the barber doesn't shave. If the barber, if, you know, he is being shaved by the barber, then... This alarm should come up every time we deal with a paradox. It would be so handy. But do you see the paradox here? Yeah? It's an impossible situation. You cannot have the either or. It's the condition, the situation of the barber is undecidable. Yeah? You cannot have a set that contains within it the set itself. Yeah? So that's this logical insight by was introduced by Gödel into mathematics because, you know, we can live with many paradoxes. We know the Zeno paradoxes are already with us for 2,500 years. They show us that logic is faulty, that there are paradoxes within our logic. But we're kind of okay with it because we say, yes, our logic is not perfect. But that's okay, because we have mathematics. In mathematics, we don't encounter these paradoxes. In mathematics, there is certainty. If you say 2 plus 3 equals 5, it will always and forever be 2 plus 3 equals 5, and it cannot be anything else. Gödel came and said, this, what is true about logic in general, is also true about mathematics. And he shows, and it's, his proof is fascinating, he shows how mathematics is also containing within itself indecidable propositions. Now, you have a question?
It's existential, but if you think of the universe as the set containing all sets, and according to that,
no,
I mean,
don't go there. I don't want to go there now. Because what I want you to somehow also bear in mind is that that was in the 30s, early 30s. 10 years later, a guy called Alan Turing was developing his computer, first electronic computer during the Second World War, as part of the British World War effort to crack the Enigma code of the British film. What is called? And the film about Turing.
The irritation game, yeah.
The limitation game. Yeah. It's a bit suffering, but it's okay. It gives you some idea what it was about. So when Alan Turing started to develop his computer, he used Gödel's insight, and computers have this notion of undecidability, because Turing realized that there is, that in the Turing machine, which is the kind of the mental prototype of a computer, there always will be situations within software, within code, that will be undecidable. In other words, there always will be some programs about which you will not be able to tell in advance whether the computer will stop after processing it or whether it will continue indefinitely. Yeah? Some programs will cause the computer to keep processing, others will cause it to stop. And it is impossible to determine in advance what will it be in some cases. So whenever you have a computer, that a computational machine that works algorithmically, the notion of undecidability is built in, just as it is built in into arithmetics. Yeah? That's why you get glitches. The glitch is the visual expression of the Gödel's undecidability theorem. The glitch is the visual expression of the paradoxes inherent in Turing machines and in logic and in mathematics. So don't look at the glitch as a sort of, oh, you know, I did bad, I got a glitch. It's that's what makes it work. Yeah? And this is why, that is why it is a scandal. You know, that's why that really shook mathematics to the core, because mathematics was the last refuge of the believer. Yeah? When everything else in the world is proven as false, there is no God, there is no hell, there is even no reason, but at least in mathematics we can trust that it would always be the same. No matter, you can, two black holes plus one more black hole will always give you three black holes, in the same way that two cigarette butts and another cigarette butt will give you, you know, it will be the same on every level, everywhere. Not so, Gödel says. Doesn't have to be. There is undecidability. That, you know, the work of art can be undecidable because of that. It doesn't need to be, it doesn't need to mean anything. It can be, it's okay for it to be undecidable. You can relax. It doesn't need to mean anything, because meaning is not what we think it is. Okay, it gets worse. Now, Vishal, can you read the next one?
It gets worse. The delicate but inescapable conclusion that given in simple maths, undecidability was the primary feature of all dynamic systems, meant also, both logically and practically speaking, that all dynamic systems, even and especially the most simple, would also always already and paradoxically be
incomplete. What does it mean about your art practice?
Never complete.
Good. Say it again.
It's never complete.
Right. So that means that your art object, whatever it is you make, is, it can never be complete. It is undecidable by design. If you ignore it, it's not going to go away. It will, you just will just have a much harder time. You know? Your work is undecidable. It, don't worry about nailing it to some specific meaning or direction. That is not the point. The point is that your work will always be, you don't need to strive for completion. Completion is pointless. I mean, completion is a metaphysical hangover. It's from the age of God. You know, God made a complete, perfect world, as Leibniz says, the best of all possible worlds. But not anymore. The world is as it is. It is what it is. And your artwork is what it is. It will be incomplete by design. How can that affect your aesthetic judgments? You know, it's interesting that in the Islamic art tradition, at least that's what I was told, maybe it's another myth, the arabesques are never complete. There always will be one element that will be out of sync with others, kind of turned around, but not quite right. It has a religious connotation. Only God can make perfect sense. But it also acquires a certain agency through this text. Yeah, incomplete. That's how things are. You know, this is, in a sense, to use Heidegger's language, how we are in the world. We are in the world in incompleteness. Incompleteness is our relationship to the world. I think on some level it gives you certain aesthetic direction for your practice. Let's see how far we can go. Let's read this to be blunt. Godel's incompleteness theory. Vishal, are you ready?
To be blunt, Godel's incompleteness theory understood the fact that whatever sense of truth entered from those, which is whatever plus one or whatever minus one comforts them, had more to do with mimetic bio assemblages,
yes,
and respectively linked recursive logics, than to the semiotics of representation. Sign, signifier.
Good. Stop here for a second. That's a good sentence. All right. What do you hear here?
Well, the mathematical theorem is already kind of view of the world. It's really just relating to its own theory and can't touch on the real world outside.
Say it again.
Theory of truth, or anything, just relates to itself and its own principles and can't touch on the real world and tell you something about the so-called transcendental truth.
Read this sentence, please, Michel. It meant that?
It meant that a fragment was not always or only a portion of the whole, say a slice of the pie or a piece of the puzzle. Sometimes a fragment just was.
Just is. That's right. What is a fragment here? How do you understand the fragment? Cast your mind back. The other thing we discussed also starts with F. Good. Thank you. Finally, we are getting to the fractals. Now we are getting the fractals through, not through Mandelbrot and his alternative geometry. We get to the fractal through the whole torturous story of philosophy finding a way out of metaphysics. Well, first finding its way in metaphysics and then out. So Godel's incompleteness theorem, we are not studying here the history of mathematics at all. What we are looking at is art. And what the question we ask ourselves is how our understanding of Godel's theorem helps us to figure out the language of contemporary art. Yeah. So, what Godel is putting on the table is that there is no system that is complete. All systems are essentially incomplete by dint of them being a system. If you want a system, you have to accept its incompleteness. Now, later on, if you stick with the program, we will also discuss how it is possible to do things without a system. You don't have to necessarily have a system. That is a separate story. But if you're going to have a system like mathematics, or logic, or electronic computers, indecidability, incompleteness, glitches, errors, will be built in. They are not sort of bad things that happen. And if you try a little harder, if you rewrite your code, if you improve your soldering, you will eliminate it. No. They are how this thing works. Okay, that's the first thing. That all